hoping this works. Sorry, I couldn't be there in person, but I tested positive for COVID 2 days before I was about to fly, and had to cancel absolutely everything. My throat's still a little bit delicate, but hopefully I can get through this, and it is of some use to you. But I'm very disappointed not to be there in person and in Athens. So hopefully this works. I'm recording it on Zoom. So I'm going to talk about an ongoing project called Immersive Telepresence in Theatre, but I'm also going to talk about arts education in general using online tools, because we rarely engage with online technology, except of course when we were forced into it through COVID. But we've been doing this since 2016. And actually, there are many other people using advanced networks, as we call them, for performing arts education across the globe, as I discovered. I should say that I'm an anti-tech person. I use this quote, online tools aren't better, they're just better than nothing. But what we do is we use a lot of technology in order to make technology invisible, as you'll see. So I've quite a few clips to show, and hopefully this will make some sense. This is what we've been doing so far. We've mainly been working with Tampere University in Finland, but we've worked with a lot of other universities. And that's the timeline of the projects we've attempted so far. I should say 2020, got us online, was truncated because of COVID. 2021, there obviously was a pandemic, so we couldn't do a project at all because we couldn't even get into the building. And in 2022, as I will discuss at the end, the project was similarly still affected by COVID. So hopefully we'll manage to get a non-COVID project out next year, although it seems unlikely. So quickly, here's a 2-minute film explaining kind of an overview of what it is we've been doing.
In the end, I was really surprised how immersive it could be to act out a scene just with this screen in as the connector.
But once you got used to it kind of felt that we were in the same room. All the distance got smaller and smaller.
It's made the world seem smaller, it's more accessible.
I
Yeah,
love it.
I
I can't get enough of it.
I
I do love it.
genuinely,
I love
I love this project.
Yeah.
I love how unique it is.
So really, this was a great way to bring people from other countries together in the same room, really, and open up new possibilities for future projects. I feel like this is very beneficial for us thinking about the future. Now we have all these new people in our lives who live in another country.
It's a worthy tool, and it should never be thought of as a gimmick. It's a good tool.
And once we got the hold of it was really like a very magical experience, almost,
it
to
was,
have these
yeah.
people in the same room with you, and also it's another country, life-sized.
We all sort of came together as sort of like kids in a playground, and kids make friends without worry, and we all sort of jumped at each other like and made friends.
So it was quite exciting, the whole experiment. So it really felt that we met personally, and during the virtual lessons that we were in the same room, and the distance got smaller and smaller. Yeah, I'm repeating myself.
So hopefully that gives you a little sense of what I'm going to talk about. I mean, we started this project out of a position of complete ignorance because we just wanted to do some collaboration online. And we had no idea until we started to do research into it how far back this idea of artistic collaboration using networks went. And right back to even pre-1897, back to 1874 with a thing called the electroharmonic telegraph. But this gadget, the teleharmonium, Teddeus Cahill's invention, was the idea to have distributed music before the advent of radio. So it used the telephone lines. The second version of it weighed 200 tons. It had its own building in New York, which they used, and actually was discontinued because it affected the New York Stock Exchange. So it sucked up back in the day, what could it, we would term as bandwidth, it used that much bandwidth that it actually brought down the New York Stock Exchange and was melted down eventually. So that's how far back the idea of kind of collaborating online in the arts goes back. The kind of key experiment was this hole in space known as the mother of all video chats, or the world's first Skype call. And it was an installation by two artists, Kit Galloway and Sherry Rabinowitz, that linked a department store in New York and Century City in Los Angeles. There was no context provided for this. It was used a satellite link and basically a large video screen with audio linked by satellite was presented in both spaces. Here's a brief clip just showing you how people reacted to this way back in 1980.
Who are we talking to? Are they actors? They look like young people in a show.
They're just people like you and me.
My God, it looks like Chorus Line having a little lunch break. It must
be. They just walk by someplace and like they're just talking because they saw this just like we saw it.
How did you get here?
They're probably.
I just walked.
Do we know what's going on? Do you know what's going on?
No, not really.
So something which became completely commonplace for us during COVID, you see back in 1980 how mind-blowing it was. In my world, the idea of kind of music education or arts education really came about in 1991 with Pauline Oliveros, who used a gadget called PictureTel. That's about the best picture I could get of a PictureTel thing. And they started to use private internet developed by DARPA in the US, to kind of, you know, collaborate and teach music together. The image was actually updated every 5 seconds, so you can imagine the latency and what they had to cope with back then. But that idea of music education, which really was the first out of the gate before drama or dance or theatre, and the next couple of slides are some technologies which are available at the minute and some examples of how they're used, which are the kind of more common ones for music education. The first one is LOLA, low latency audio, which was developed in Trieste in consortium with GAR, the Italian Research and Academic Network. And it was developed by academics and is still really, really heavily used in music education across the world and performance. It's based on PC architecture, so it's a very specially designed PC with very specific parts in it. The complete kit costs around 12,000 euros, only works with certain hardware configurations. And the other one, which is kind of ubiquitous in music as well, is UltraGrid MVTP, which was developed in the Czech Republic. UltraGrid software-based, it requires some coding knowledge and is actually free. And it's fantastic. The latency can be as low as 50 milliseconds. I'll talk about latency in a second. And MVTP is a kind of hardware version of that. So it's a kind of solution in a box. I'm going to show you now a collaboration between Tallinn and Prague. And so the pianist in Tallinn and the cellist in Prague doing MVTP later. And again, this is a performance where the cellist is in Vilnius in Lithuania and the pianist is in Tallinn in Estonia, and they're using LOLA to do a concert together. Thank you. So we weren't aware of any of this when we started out. And one of the common things, but I think this has been solved during the pandemic, is it's not big Zoom. This is a much more complex way of working. We actually started with Skype. We didn't intend to go down the rabbit hole that we went down, but we actually started with Skype and got nowhere. And it began in 2016 when we wanted to make a project together, me based at Coventry University and some colleagues based at Tampere University. And we wanted to do some Shakespeare for Shakespeare's 400th anniversary of Shakespeare's death. And we needed to find a technological solution to rehearsing 1,125 miles approximately apart. And everything else we went for just seemed to be a really imperfect solution, as, again, we discovered during the pandemic when we were all back in our living rooms. This was the initial test in 2015, and this was the space we intended to use with a TV screen and some video conferencing software. But again, as you can see, you can't see the full body. You can't really see the facial expressions. We didn't even know what the word telepresence was way back then. We just tried to use the tools that we were able to access, and you know, everything didn't seem to work. So we couldn't get that room because other people had booked it for meetings, which turned out to be a godsend. So what the room we thought we could have got, and that was the height of our ambition at that time, we couldn't get. So we ended up building our own space in a disused wind tunnel, the Charles Ward wind tunnel. That's a kind of behind the scenes look. So we ended up using stage technology and video conferencing technology together to build our essentially our own space. It was a horrible space, but what we discovered there was very interesting. We had a terrible echo, which caused all kinds of problems. We didn't know why, because most of these systems have echo cancellation. We couldn't really light it properly. Although what we did discover led us to learn about our topic. So this is one of those weird things where we did it first and then learned about it later. So these were the requirements we kind of put down as things that you need to use when you're working in the arts, and you can't get all of them. It needs to be easy to use. There needs to be decent audio video quality, quite low latency, and needs to be accessible to both parties. And you don't need to be a technician, but you need to understand the limitations of the technology in order to work in this way together. We're all familiar with bandwidth, latency, and jitter because of COVID, but these are the considerations we always talk about. Latency, like the road, the longer it is, the longer the latency. The number of lanes on the road is the bandwidth. So ideally, you want something low latency, high bandwidth. You want as few roadblocks on the way with jitter, but latency is always going to be with us. We can't beat it. The speed of light in a vacuum is 186,282 miles per second. I used to not know that. Now I do, unfortunately. In any other medium, it's a lot slower. So even going through optical fibers with no boundaries at all, it's a full 31% slower. You also go through lots of switches when you go from country to country. I mean, although they take nanoseconds, they're still switches and they don't discern over who's there. So you're queuing with spreadsheets and cat videos and Harry Styles videos. So it makes no difference, but they're still slowing you down. And oddly, getting out of your campus and getting into the other campus are where the most slowdown will happen. And everything in the room causes latency as well. So although you can't do anything about physics, you can do things about latency in the room. You know, a latency of 20 milliseconds gives the impression of participants being 20 feet apart. 40 milliseconds becomes challenging for musicians, although actors can cope with this because we have the speed of thought. So everything, the camera, the microphones, everything that's converting a digital or an analog signal to something, so any processing in the room, is causing latency. So you can do as much as you can to eliminate that from the room, because you can't eliminate in real life. I'm going to show you two quick clips in succession. One is us performing between Hong Kong and Finland. So we were asked to do a performance in Hong Kong to show off the system, but the longest latency time we've ever experienced. And the other clip is the very first year when we tried to play a children's game called Grandmother's Footsteps and really discovered the limitation of what we had attempted.
Latency, we can have a little demonstration.
So we usually do a clap test to demonstrate. We try and clap together.
One, two, three, clap,
and this was to demonstrate it to the audience very much.
Okay. I'll count it in. So when we get to three, everyone here clap. So I'm tired as well. And then you'll hear the difference. So one, two, three. Yeah.
Everybody!
So, yeah, so our experiments kind of started to show the flaws in the system. This is a diagram of the way we kind of set up the room. We use a Polycom video conferencing system, which is fairly ubiquitous. People use it for business meetings. So that was, we still use it. We have something slightly more advanced, which I'll show just towards the end. But I mean, we're working with Florida, hopefully in January this year. And we're going to use this because it's entry level. It's really easy to get your hands on. If you don't have one, it's very cheap to rent, but actually most campuses have them. They're just usually in meeting rooms. So it's persuading someone on the campus to let you borrow one out of the meeting room. The cons are you have to use the camera, which is a little bit fisheye, but it's not that bad. It's a little bit dated given where the technology is heading, but it's not bad. It works fine, and we've used it for years, and we used it in our last version as well. It's fine. It's relatively simple. Even after a little bit of tuition, our students can use it as well. The setup is we take a rear projection screen and we make it flush to the floor. And we use a lot of kind of just ordinary stage equipment in order to do that. And we have microphones which actually pick up the whole room in real life. So the further you are from the screen, the louder you have to be. We want to mimic the dynamics of a real space so that people don't think about the technology. As I said at the very start, I use a lot of technology to make technology invisible. If we could make the camera even smaller, we would. We discovered that the camera has to be slightly above waist height. That gives the impression of eye contact, which is very important. And I have a quick little clip of us setting up the system. I'll not play all of it. It does take a long time to set up, and you'll see there's been a time lapse of us setting up. I've also timestamped it, so you can see how long the first day actually takes. This was in 2020 when we used a slightly more
common... Can you hear me, Matthias?
So that's Matthias in Finland, and he obviously can't hear us.
Hello, Matthias, we can see you.
We've not set up the system correctly.
Good, we can't hear you. That you're there, even though you don't know that we're there. But the picture's nice, look.
We know what we're seeing today.
So now we're using a back
channel. Yeah, 1 p.m. finish time.
So we're just using...
Yeah, we'll try again then.
...to talk to each other about what the flow in the system is.
Yeah, you can have lunch.
Right, we have a connection. I'm just going to show everybody on Facebook. So, Matthias, can you talk to prove that we have a connection?
I can talk to you, and I can talk to everybody listening.
Okay, so there we are. We are connected. We can go tomorrow morning.
So, when we started to kind of teach this way, we had all kinds of esoteric problems about where are the participants located? Do we need a new way of teaching? And it was an experiment, but one of the really pleasing things we discovered is we didn't really alter our teaching that much in that it does function as a single space. Obviously, you can't touch, But in terms of kind of being able to rehearse and participate together, there wasn't a hell of a lot of difference. We did make some rookie mistakes. We taped out an area on the floor because we thought that would be really good for the students to kind of see when they were in full body view. It actually was very limiting to the students, so we got rid of the tape on both sides and let them really play with it, because it's not a real space. It's a semi-live, semi-digital space. So we kind of responded to what the students wanted to do, which is experiment more with the camera. I'm still showing this slide. We've all had virtual beer over COVID. I had a virtual Christmas day because I couldn't go back home to my parents. But we used a three-room system, and we still use this three-room system. We use Facebook, which is very much our notice board, and to kind of put scripts, to put scheduling up, a kind of private group. We used Adobe Connect at the very start as kind of breakout rooms for students to learn their lines, kind of work with each other. And we used the big room as our main rehearsal room. But of course, students did what students do. And they, you know, had beer, they played music with each other, they talked about films. And this was an accidental discovery, but we use Zoom now. But again, it's something that we very, very much encourage, because when you're working remotely, one of the problems is just having the lesson ends and no kind of point of contact between the students, no social contact between the students, which when you're doing kind of group work changes when the students all get to know each other. So this breakout space, this space which the tutors don't go into, this space which is their own essentially private room where they can even bitch about us if they want, is very important. And we started to really experiment with what we could do in this space in terms of how is it different than a real rehearsal space. And, you know, we played with the camera. So this is a clip from a collaboration with America where we played with objects. So this was when we did Galileo by Bertolt.
What? This is the Earth.
I've got a good example on that, Mr. Galileo. You can prove anything with those.
Well, this is the Earth. And this... is you sitting on it. And now the Earth turns.
And now I'm hanging my head upside down.
Huh. Look carefully. Where is your head?
There. Underneath.
What? Is your head not where it was before? Are your feet still not on the ground? Are you like this?
So it became a kind of mix between film acting and stage acting. And again, when we did King Lear with Temporary, we became very interested in the idea of being able to do close-ups, which you can't really do with another actor in a live sense. So this was a scene where we made a breakthrough, and actually the actors kind of came up with the idea first.
You must stay with me. Pray now, forget and forgive, for I am old and foolish.
Yeah.
Do you feel like touching her?
I don't mean that
in a sinister way.
I feel like we should be like that we can't.
Yeah,
it's just using that, you know, the eye contact is so difficult because yeah. I know, is there any possibility to get any eye contact?
Yeah, when you look into the camera, you're looking straight into her eyes. So when she looks at, see, if I look there, I'm looking at you.
Yeah.
And if you look there, you're looking at me. So, I mean, don't be afraid of, like, almost trying to touch the screen, you know?
Yeah.
And see what happens. Should we do this one more time and then we'll swap over you guys? And we'll play as well? Yeah.
You know, because here it looks like you're huge.
But see, here, the glands in your forehead.
It's good for the scene. I think it's good for the scene because, like, there's this big moment for Lear.
Yeah.
So it gives some, like, I feel myself really small right now.
I'll take a picture and I can, you know,
I'm
then you can see the afterwards how it looks like.
Oh.
This is great.
So we kind of took a picture and also put it on Facebook so that the actors could see what each other looked like, and we could kind of line up the image correctly. The answer to do we ignore or embrace the technology is actually both, paradoxically, in that there's a lovely quote from one of the Finnish students, Santeri, who said, we all know how the technology works. We're all aware of how the technology works. But after a few days, your brain is just stupid enough to convince you that these people are on the other side of the room to you. And it's amazing the way the dynamic can actually work out. Again, another quick clip of a game we always play together in an actual physical space where there is no leader. And people just go around and they decide them amongst themselves when to stop, when to fall to the floor, and when to stand back up again. And it's about group dynamics. So technically, it shouldn't work in a digital space, yet it does. So this was from this year's collaboration, which just happened in March. So the instruction is there is no leader. They just move around the space and slow down together, and then eventually stop together, and then eventually fall to the floor. So they kind of have to sense what the other, not only what their own group is doing in the Coventry side, but what people are doing in the Finnish side. So it's very interesting to us to see the connections between these two spaces and the whole, both spaces functioning as a single. We've had lots of weird experiments in terms of performance. Coventry went for City of Culture. We organized a banquet between two cities at the same time. So we've been in unusual places such as the foyer of a building, where we arranged for two identical deals. Not so much in terms of teaching, but interesting in terms of us working our problem.
But it looks really nice from here.
You need to decide where he's going to drop his.
Yeah, you just need to decide where you're going to drop your money.
We will have a box on this side. You need to land it in a box wherever.
Yeah.
It's
there.
Right.
Okay. And this is a collaboration between Helsinki and Gutenberg. The Gutenberg students were actually in Helsinki and us back in 2018, where the latency got much better, as you can kind of see, because we're doing a lot more passing and playing between both sides. So at this point, we'd become very good with the technology. So at this point, we kind of learned a lot. And a lot of what we do is play. A lot of what we do is actually play in terms of how we interact with each other. So I'm going to move on to the most complicated thing we've ever done, where we use new technology. I mean, and again, this was at a conference and we did the opening performance and we used this gadget, which is really the Rolls Royce of this, and we have one now. So this is known as the Nimbra, made by a Swedish company called Net Insight. If you watch Netflix, if you watch Prime, this is probably what's powering it. And it's designed primarily for live broadcast. It's eye-wateringly expensive and really complicated to use. It's ultra low latency and it's designed to have multitudes of devices plugged in. You could do remote surgery with this. It is a brute of a machine. But it means you can use different cameras and you can have multiple streams. In terms of in classroom work, it's become very, very, very commonly used in classrooms across the Scandinavian region. We're using an ultra low latency Blackmagic camera there, which is incredibly expensive, probably more expensive than the equipment we used in the first year alone. And that's a little diagram for anyone who's quite nerdy who wants to see how things work there. And this is a map of people who are using Nimbus for either education or artistic purposes. As you can see, we're the only one in the UK at the minute. And the primary drivers of this are the Nordic regions who actually have a group called the Nordic Center for Digital Presence, which is kind of powering a lot of the education and arts work across the kind of Nordic regions. There's one even in Greenland, but I'm blocking that with my head on the slide. And we used it to do live motion capture between Miami and...
He'd come home from work and accuse her of spending the day with someone else. He'd start to yell at her and smash things in the trailer.
Trailer.
So in the top corner, you can see the actual actor in Tampa who's in a portable green suit. And in Miami,
they
transmitted to an avatar. So again, very interesting, not so much. And we've also used another screen, a live musician.
Why are you in to visit me the other day?
Anyway.
And actually, the most difficult thing about that was the actor in America. In 2020, our project was very much cut short. We worked on Waiting for Godot, which was very interesting. We used a lot of new technologies, which we were still learning how to use. But unfortunately, you know, we were meant to travel to Finland to perform and work together because what we do is mainly blended learning. So there's a lot online and followed by a field trip, but literally both countries shut down just at the very end of it. So that didn't happen. And then this year, we came back with Attempts on Our Life with Finland. And again, was affected by both COVID and artistic differences. This is a slide that I just started to use. It's actually a slide from the sitcom Friends, and it's where the character Rachel is trying to make a trifle, and but the pages have got stuck together, so she gets confused with the shepherd's pie. And when you're collaborating artistically in both areas, it's really, really important that both of you are making the same recipe. And I think on this occasion, because there was a new person in Finland, we were not entirely in simpatico. So it was a difficult, not entirely unsuccessful collaboration. But I think that the very easy relationship we'd built up over the years with kind of familiar colleagues in Finland we were slightly at odds with each other, and I do also take some responsibility for that. I mean, again, we used Facebook to kind of put the script up, so that's kind of an example of the Facebook post. We created some learning materials, so I created a little handout for students because this is quite an experimental play. But we had a constantly changing cast because of COVID, so even I missed the last 2 days. So I came in, I hadn't felt well the day before, but I was testing negative. I got in really, really early in the morning to set up. So I was in about 6 a.m. in the morning and I took a COVID test. And as you can see, the two lines. So I actually left instructions on Facebook for the students to basically get started themselves today and then wiped everything down with antiseptic wipes. And the students managed to go. Craig is our technician, so I knew they'd be in before him and they were relying on me. So I left a little how-to guide and kind of monitored the whole thing by Zoom. Again, you'll see even on the first day, we had a constantly shifting cast because on both sides, both Tampere and Coventry, the cast, the students just constantly changed. This was our introductory session.
It's me and Jama from
Is it? Yay!
High tech meets low tech.
Yama is from. Do you want to tell yourself or do you want?
Is there any? I can't hear you.
I don't know. That's...
Okay, Yama.
Hey, we did actually hear that, so...
And again, there also was a lot of play and a lot of passing. You'll see both clips from both sides. So this is just students pass some objects. So we usually reserve some time for students to just play with whatever they want and kind of test the limits of the technology and what they can do. You'll not see this from the other side.
But we don't see it appear, so... So, Tom, try throwing at the same time as he does and see what happens.
So there's a lot of play. I'm just going to pause this for a second. So one last clip. We had a very multinational cast. Obviously, we had the Finns on one side, but on our side, we had Lithuanian, Polish, Romanian, Hong Kong, Korean. And so we wanted to do something which had a multitude of kind of languages and was quite experimental approach. So this is one final clip from the very last thing we did, which was Attempts on Her Life. And I think you'll see the way we were kind of trying to use languages as a way to kind of be a bit more international than when we started out with Shakespeare.
She enjoys her work. She enjoys her work.
Podoba jej się praca.
She is young and fit and happy with her body.
Güçlü, mutlu ve vücuduyla aşırı derecede mutlu.
And what she got with her body is her decision.
Și ce face cu corpul ei este decizia ei.
Porno doesn't stop her from leading a normal life.
Porno, onu normal bir hayat yaşamaktan mahrum bırakmaz.
She has a regular boyfriend.
Normal bir erkek arkadaşı var.
And all the normal interests of a girl her age.
I wszystkie normalne zainteresowane dziewczyny w jej wieku.
Clothes.
Ubrania.
Boys.
Los chicos.
Makeup, pets.
Maquillage, animales de compañía.
Music.
So, that's the end of my presentation. I'm really, really sorry I couldn't be there in person, but I didn't want to spread my germs anywhere. I'd usually say any questions, but we have a website in which everything is archived and there's full video materials of everything we've done. And if anyone wants to get in contact with me, that's my email address at Coventry University. We're always up for new collaborators. So if you know anyone at your organization that wants to play, that wants to work and wants to do something together, please don't hesitate to give me a shout. I mean, especially with the loss of Erasmus, sorry to get all political at the very end. It's still very important for me that we maintain our contacts with Europe and that we continue to make European work from the UK. Despite the lack of funding. So I hope this made some sense to you. I hope you enjoyed it and have a really good time in Athens. Thank you very much. Goodbye.